LAist 89.3, the LAist app, LAist.com. Get the news 24/7 across Southern California. LAist, anytime, anywhere.
LAist and Show and Tell present an evening with David Sedaris. The writer, humorist, and radio contributor will take the stage Saturday, November 16th at the United Theater on Broadway. Tickets and information at laist.com/events.
Good morning, it's Air Talk. I'm Larry Mantle. Well, last night, the Dodgers' backs against the proverbial wall came up with an 8-0 shutout victory over the San Diego Padres in San Diego, setting up a decisive Game 5 at Dodgers Stadium tomorrow at 5 o'clock. The Dodgers, with their dramatically depleted starting rotation, threw what's called a bullpen game last night, meaning only relief pitchers in very short spurts took to the mound, and they were dominant over a Padres lineup which is full of terrific hitters. It was an upset, and now the Dodgers in position back at Dodger Stadium with a conventional starting pitcher tomorrow night, with a chance to move on to meet the Mets in the best of seven National League championship series. Joining me is the Tripleplay to talk about where the Dodgers stand right now. Nick Roman, the former host of LAist All Things Considered, and A. Martinez, host of NPR's Morning Edition. A and Nick, so good to have you with us. A, let me start with you. You surprised that the Dodger pitching was so strong using only relievers.
Yeah, especially, yeah, as you said, the way they did it with all those relievers, having arguably the greatest bullpen game of all time, and then to have it in the postseason too, that adds to the specialness. But that, to me, that's a backbreaker for the Padres. They have a chance to close out the Dodgers at home in front of all their fans who hate everything that has to do with Los Angeles. It's a wonderful opportunity for them to finally shake off all the ghosts of Dodgers playoff defeats past, and to finally, you know, just stamp their selves as a new era of Padre baseball. And then, as you said, all these relievers gather together to shut down a very potent Padres lineup. One of their best pitchers, Dylan Cease, gets roughed up early, has to lead before he finishes the second inning. And then the Dodgers coast to this shutout win, which I think brings it back to L.A. And I'm sorry, San Diego, if our signal gets extended down to San Diego, your time in the postseason is over.
No way. Saying it's over, and we would get a coast-to-coast championship series matchup of the Dodgers and Mets. Nick, your thoughts about Mookie Betts, because they talking about how Cease got roughed up early. Two straight games where the first at-bat Mookie Betts has are home runs.
Yeah, well, you know, we've been waiting for Mookie to be the Mookie that we saw during the playoffs in 2020 when he drove the Dodgers to the World Championship that year. And he's back in form, and that's great because, you know, having Shohei Ohtani at the top, that's terrific. But you need another threat so that, you know, teams could look at Ohtani and go, well, we have to pitch to him because if we don't, then we get Mookie. The one bad thing, of course, is that there's no Freddie Freeman behind Mookie Betts, but Teoscar Hernandez takes care of that too right now. So, you know, it was great to see Mookie back doing Mookie things, you know, home runs in the first inning, singles when you need them, driving in runs and doing all the great stuff. And, you know, his outfield defense is just perfect all the time. That's a big deal. The better Mookie is, the better the Dodgers are. We all know that.
Nick, what do you think about Dave Roberts' decision to keep Freddie Freeman out of the lineup? In his postgame comments last night, it wasn't clear whether Freeman, you know, could have been, whether he wanted to be in the lineup. It sounded like Roberts thought he was too compromised defensively to play first base with his bad ankle, but that, of course, takes his bat out of the lineup as well. So, you know, what are your thoughts of, you know, how you balance out what you lose on defense when he has limited mobility versus his bat?
Well, you know, Max Muncy was a great first baseman when he was playing over there during that 2020 season. The only reason Max is at third base is because the Dodgers signed Freddie Freeman. And that play the other night when Freddie Freeman's throw bounced off of Manny Machado, if Freddie is healthy, if his ankle is fine, I don't think that play happens. I think he's able to stand up and not fall down and make the throw, or, you know, turn around and just get the out at first base. And the Dodgers probably end up, even though the game score was terrible, you know, didn't work out their way, probably end up winning that game. I'm sure that Freddie Freeman could have done, you know, the old Kirk Gibson thing and been a pinch hitter if they needed him. And certainly the bad ankle didn't hurt him at the plate. He got a couple of hits the other night. But Kike Hernandez, who then moves on into third base in Freeman's spot, is an excellent postseason hitter, and he showed it last night. So you don't, for at least one game, you don't lose too much. But it's not the kind of thing you want to do for a long, long time.
And Hernandez, arguably a better defensive third baseman than even Max Muncy, who plays that as, on a regular basis. A, how is it that Kike Hernandez, when the playoffs come around, becomes like a whole other player? What happens to him?
Of to rise to the occasion, clearly. And some players are built that way. So, I mean, we've seen players in the past, and not just baseball, but in basketball and in football, where they have, you know, they're valuable parts of a team's regular season. But when the postseason arrives, it's like some new gear, something flips in their brain. Well, all of a sudden their talent amplifies and they become more locked in than they would have been over 152 games. Some guys are just built that way. And clearly Kiki is definitely built that way, because I don't know how many more times he has to do things in the postseason to prove that he is a clutch postseason player that you have to have on a roster, if not for the entire 6 months of the season, to wait for these moments like this in October.
And he's showing it now. Yu Darvish, who was dominant in game two for the Padres, he's pitching tomorrow night in Los Angeles. And it looks like Yamamoto is going to be on the mound for the Dodgers. A, your thoughts about that matchup?
Well, as I said before, it's over. The Padres have long been a unbelievably entertaining, fun, cocky team. I love that stuff. You guys know me. I love that stuff.
Yeah.
It's what draws me to watch sports is having these guys go out there and really kind of put it out there, and they don't care what anyone thinks of them. But in order to continue to kind of be beloved that way, you got to win a few games. You got to like exercise some ghosts. And they had the chance yesterday. They didn't. I think that's an emotional backbreaker. It doesn't matter to me if the Dodgers decide to do the whole bullpen thing again, just one day later. This series is over. The Padres had their chance yesterday to bring this thing back to Los Angeles. It's going to be a mountain, big blue mountain that Padres brown and gold is not going to be able to climb.
I love it. Nick?
I think he's right. I would always delve into stats when you get to these kind of things. Yu Darvish is going to pitch for the Padres tomorrow. It'll be 4 days rest. He pitched on 4 days rest only four times this season, and every time he did, he gave up runs. 21 innings, 17 earned runs. So that's a good omen for the Dodgers. Padres haven't scored for the last 15 innings. That's a really good omen for the Dodgers. And I think A's right. You know, Dave Roberts had promised pitching chaos because the starters for the Dodgers are so banged up. But they didn't really do it in the playoffs until yesterday. And when they pulled out that bullpen game, and it worked like a charm. The frontline relief pitchers, Michael Kopech, Evan Phillips, Blake Treinen, and Alex Vesia, in this series, they've pitched in 10 and a third innings. It's almost a third of all the innings pitched in this series. They haven't given up a run. They've struck out 12 batters. What the heck? Do it again.
I also want to share the Dodgers, with them being one game away from advancing to the championship series, LAist is giving away a four-pack of Loge-level tickets to tomorrow night's game at Dodger Stadium, 5 o'clock first pitch. Support LAist today. You'll automatically be entered to win. Again, it's a sweepstakes today and till midday tomorrow. Go to laist.com/give. We have a four-pack of Loge-level tickets to tomorrow, 5 o'clock game, Dodgers and Padres at Dodger Stadium, LAS.com/give. So the Mets, the Mets looked like nothing early in the season, a total wreck. And in fact, everybody's wondering whether they're just going to, you know, sell off the team for parts. And here they end up on this incredible run, which can happen in the postseason and is happening to them. What do you make of the Mets, A?
Oh, it's Lindor. I mean, they got him, the shortstop, Francisco Lindor, for this exact reason. I mean, I think if you look at what they paid to get him and what he has given them for the regular season, I mean, you could argue that maybe it wasn't worth it. But now you can understand why that money all of a sudden might be worth it, because in the postseason, when you do these kinds of things, everything's forgiven and forgotten. Things that you didn't do well in the regular season, slow starts to seasons that cost you bids in the playoffs, because, as I've always said, the games in April and May count just as much as the ones in September and October to get you to the postseason. So it's Lindor. He has become the leader, the captain, the soul of that team, and he has put them on their back, and now they're right there waiting for the Dodgers and Padres to figure out who's going
to
meet them.
Well, and their bullpen is to say it's shaky is to be charitable, Nick, which we hear how important relief pitching is in the playoffs. Nonetheless, they're holding up.
You know, in a short series, sometimes, you know, guys find it and they pitch well. They do have a good closer in Edwin Diaz, although, you know, he has at times.
He's broken down, you know, yeah.
He's broken down, hasn't looked great. The player that impresses me is their kid third baseman for the Mets, Mark Vientos, whom they brought up early in the season. And he's hitting like crazy. So, you know, teams will get hot. The Mets got hot in the right time. They took on a team that they were very familiar with. The Philadelphia Phillies play them a whole bunch in that division, and they beat them. And I was surprised, because the Phillies, I thought, were probably the best team in the National League, maybe, you know, probably better than the Dodgers. But the Phillies just couldn't hit, and the Mets are finding magic all over the place, which is sort of like Mets history, I guess.
Yeah. And the Tigers, similarly in the American League, a team that's come on late in the season, just got into the playoffs as a wild card team. And now they are on the verge of eliminating the Cleveland Guardians, who had the second best record overall, got the bye in the first round of the American League Divisional Series. Hey, your thoughts on the Tigers? What's fueling their rise?
Well, I think clearly is when we spoke the last time, and I picked the Tigers to go all the way to the American League. I don't like to pat myself on the back, guys. You know that I'm very humble and modest on a lot of things, but I have to take credit for this one, because there's something about that team. There's something about that team, and them not trading Tarek Skubal, who was their ace, one of the best pitchers in the American League, well, not the American, in all of Major League Baseball last year. There was actually thoughts of trading him, because the Tigers, they thought maybe they weren't going to be in the postseason this year. I couldn't believe it when I heard it, because that's why you develop a guy like him, to carry to the postseason and to win those key games in the playoffs. But not trading him, not making that move, was the best move that the Tigers didn't make. And now they're in a position to maybe face the Yankees or Royals in the ALCS.
In that game, by the way, the Guardians and Tigers, 3 o'clock this afternoon, to be followed by the Yankees and Royals. The Yankees up 2-1 in that series. Nick, your thoughts about the two American League divisional rounds?
Well, I'm with A. The Tigers are red hot. They've been building that team for a long time. They have a lot of young guys. Probably nobody knows outside of that pitcher, Tarek Skubal, who the Tigers right now have in their back pocket. They don't need him today. They can use him in a game 5 if they have to. He pitched great in Cleveland last week. So they're in a good spot. Of course, I mean, you know, everybody wants, you know, Dodgers, Yankees. I kind of like the Royals myself, but the Yankees are a really strong, got a whole lot of great players, a lot of good pitchers. And, you know, it's difficult to beat that great Yankee team. But these games have been surprising. Everything that you would expect has happened has not happened. new things have happened. So it's a ton of fun. This is one of the best postseasons that I've seen so far.
Nevertheless, Nick, there's been criticism of the postseason format because of the quick elimination of teams with better records. We've seen this over the past few seasons. The Dodgers are exhibit A of this with their elimination by the Diamondbacks last year and the Padres 2 years ago. And there was a point here in the playoffs where it looked like the four teams that got byes in the first round who had the best record in their respective leagues were probably going to be out. But, you know, if you have a Dodgers-Yankees World Series and they're the teams with the best records in their respective leagues, does that put this criticism to rest?
It could. That's obviously what the TV networks want. They also want all of those postseason games. They want storylines that will, hold an audience and bring in new viewers. And all of this postseason stuff has pretty much done that kind of thing. But if you start adding extra teams into the playoffs, you never know how things are going to come out at the end. In the NBA, they've had, a ton of basketball teams in the playoffs for a long time. And usually, would end up with the Lakers and the Celtics. But many times the Lakers and the Celtics didn't have the best record in the league at the time that the playoffs hit. They just played well in the playoffs and ended up playing each other in the finals. So if you invite playoffs, you're doing it to get TV money, to get more fans involved, to have more games. You risk then the teams that have, slogged it out with the best record for the season of getting exhausted and getting knocked down.
Ed, a quick thought on this?
Yeah, I mean, I think as fans, we want all the games to matter, to be important to us as they are hopefully to the players. Having these short series means every single moment is vitally important. So I'm all for it.
All right, gentlemen, thanks so much. It's the Triple Play. A. Martinez, host of NPR's Morning Edition. Nick Roman, a former host of LAS All Things Considered. And I'm sure we'll be back together again to talk about the Dodgers, hopefully after another win. Again, the Dodgers and the Padres, decisive Game 5 at Dodgers Stadium tomorrow at 5 o'clock. It's Air Talk on LAist 89.3. Coming up, we debate California Proposition 32. It would, in stages, raise the state minimum wage to $18 an hour. We'll talk about it when we come back in 1 minute.
I'm Jill Replogle, the Orange County correspondent for LAist. I'm here to help Orange County voters navigate local ballot measures. We'll also have voter guides for the Irvine and Santa Ana City Council races. From decisions like potential new ethics rules to how much city council members should be paid, LAist is here to help you do your research this election season. For help on your ballot, go to laist.com/OCVote.
LAist and Show and Tell present An Evening with David Sedaris. The humorist, comedian, author, and radio contributor will take the stage at the United Theater on Broadway to share insights, read from both published and unpublished work, and host a live Q&A with the audience, followed by a book signing. It's Saturday, November 16th at the United Theater. Tickets and information at laist.com/events.
It's Air Talk on LAist 89.3. I'm Larry Mantle. We're taking each of the California ballot propositions and many of the local measures, hearing the pros and cons and giving you a chance to be better informed when you cast your vote by November 5th. We turn our attention now to California Proposition 32, which would in stages raise the statewide minimum wage eventually to $18 an hour. With us is the main financial backer of the proposal, anti-poverty advocate Joe Sandberg. Joe, thank you for being with us. Share with us why you think an initiative like this is the best way to go to raise the state minimum wage.
Well, thanks for having me. Everyone who works full-time should be able to afford life's basic needs. And right now in California, there are millions of people who are working full-time and more than full-time, but don't have enough money to pay for rent, food, health care for their kids. Over the last 4 years, everything has gone up except wages. And it's time that we ensure that workers are participating in California's prosperity. And what's more, what's really important for listeners to understand is that because we have a consumer economy, when you put more money in the hands of workers and they spend that money in local communities, all businesses thrive more, hire more, and you create an economic multiplier effect that enhances prosperity for everyone, not just the workers who are getting a raise.
So if there's the multiplier effect like that, why not just raise everybody's wages, double everybody's wages? If there's a multiplier effect and it's all, you pay people more money and it just comes right back and you've got a perpetual fiscal machine there, I mean, wouldn't that argument extend even beyond this?
Well, first of all, you know, with respect, when we're talking about the real world of policymaking, we have to tackle the evidence of how policy works in the real world. And it's about striking balances. You know, we live in a market economy, but it's a market economy where we also provide cushions so that people don't fall below basic standards of living. So I think in function, no, of course, we shouldn't artificially, set wages across the board. And I think that's a different question than this fundamental issue, which is, shouldn't you be able to get at least a living wage when you work full time? I think those are two different things. In fact, I would go further and say, if we're allowing businesses to pay workers so little that they can't afford food and healthcare, then what happens is we as taxpayers have to subsidize that food and healthcare, which really means that we're subsidizing corporate profits. Corporations make more money by paying their workers so little that their workers need food stamps and Medi-Cal, and then we as taxpayers pick up the bill. If businesses were paying their workers living wages, then you wouldn't need as many food stamps and you wouldn't need as much government aid.
Is this enough of an increase? Is this enough of an increase that it would get people off of Medi-Cal? And how many people, given the numbers of people this would apply to, do you think it would remove from the state Medi-Cal rolls?
Well, first of all, let's frame this specific increase. Raising the minimum wage to $18 per hour will mean a $3,000 annual raise for 2 million workers. And $3,000 is the difference for a lot of families of being able to provide three instead of two meals a day for their kids. Second of all, the people who are going to get a raise probably numbers actually more than 2 million. Because that doesn't account for the fact that people who earn a little bit above a minimum wage get a raise when the minimum wage goes up. Third, we're also not accounting for the fact that a lot of minimum wage workers also work overtime. So their income boost probably will be more than $3,000 a year when you include overtime. This isn't enough to end poverty. And I don't think $18 is a high enough minimum wage because I don't think it's a living wage. But that doesn't mean it's not an important step in the right direction.
No, you were just saying you thought it would remove some people from the public assistance roles, particularly with Medi-Cal. So I was just wondering if there'd been an analysis done to determine what a raise to $18 an hour, whether that would really have any impact on Medi-Cal enrollment.
Fair enough. I meant that in the context of, in the ideal world, businesses should be paying living wages so that government assistance isn't necessary. Raising the minimum wage from $16 to $18 isn't enough to accomplish a living wage for everyone, but it still makes a difference. It still means $3,000 more per year for 2 million people, which is going to help them put three meals a day on the table for their kids instead of two, buy winter clothes where they otherwise couldn't afford it.
Joe, let's talk about the fast food industry where California has a $20 an hour minimum. What have we seen in terms of the employment rate, increasing automation in fast food? What's been the response of the industry to paying more for employees in fast food?
Glad you asked, because the answer is supportive of the point that a minimum wage increase helps the whole economy. Since California raised the fast food worker minimum wage to $20, there have been 11,000 more fast food jobs created in California.
We're talking with Joe Sandberg, who is the main financial backer of Proposition 32, which in stages would raise the state minimum wage to $18 an hour and then tie it to the consumer price index. It would be capped no more than 3.5% per year, but would generally move in step with increasing prices over time. Also with us is John Kapatek, California State Director of the National Federation of Independent Business. They're in opposition to 32. John, thank you for joining us. First of all, your response to Joe saying that, in fact, after the higher fast food $20 an hour wage, that industry has expanded.
Well, you know, first of all, I would say thank you for having me. And, you know, we represent about 13,000 small businesses across the state. The word we keep hearing from small business owners is uncertainty, especially in the wake of the pandemic. And I think that's why, you know, while Mr. Sandberg's proposal here may have the best intentions, it's actually going to have the opposite effect. And we need look no further than the recent $20 minimum wage that the governor signed for fast food workers. Since April, and I'm not sure where he's getting his numbers, but, you know, we have seen a few things. We've seen higher prices for consumers. 98% of fast food franchises have increased their prices by an average of 8%. Let's be honest. Look, over the past 3 years, the cost of basic goods for Californians has increased by 20%. But in addition to that, we've seen a negative impact on workers. We've seen 70% of these franchises letting people go, nearly 10,000 total workers. You know, Pizza Hut and Roundtable have given pink slips to about 1,300 delivery drivers. And then we've also seen, you know, even in West Hollywood, since they increased it to the highest in the country at $19.07 an hour, the city of West Hollywood basically cited about a 39% loss in jobs. So, and then we're seeing businesses, you know, in June, Rubio's closed 48 stores. So the numbers and the exodus is speaking for itself. Well-intentioned, Mr. Sandberg, but at the end of the day, having the opposite effect on kind of where proponents think this would go.
John, how do you tease out, though, those negative results and chains like Rubio's that have gone under, things like that, from other trends that go on in the food industry, where typically margins are small anyway, there are food trends that come and go, places that make it and don't. How do you tease out that the $20 an hour minimum wage is the cause or primary cause?
Well, I think it's in California, sadly, it's still a very, very hostile business climate for not just franchises, but especially those small businesses on Main Street who are struggling to survive. You know, we tend to think it's death by a thousand cuts. That's one more nail in the coffin for businesses that are struggling already in the wake of the pandemic to keep their doors open. They're dealing with the challenge of even trying to rebound from the closures then. But on top of that, they're dealing with frivolous lawsuits. They're dealing with regulations, onerous leave requirements. We have the most in the country. So it's just one of a multitude of things that's just weighing them down. And this doesn't, as we've seen with the $20 minimum wage increase, this will not help. And it's not as though we haven't been doing increases. Over the past 9 years, we've seen the minimum wage increase in California every year increased by about 78% total. So it's not as though we're not being focused. It would be a little different if we hadn't done something here. But small business owners need to push the pause button. They need our policymakers
John,
to push the pause button.
What Joe was saying also is that for the you know high percentage of Californians who work in minimum wage jobs, that they would be able to spend the additional money that they have, and that would help juice the California economy. Your response to that?
Well, sure. Who doesn't want a few extra dollars in their pocket on the front end? It would certainly give them a little bit more to work with on the front end. But again, I ask at what cost? Sure, you're giving a few extra dollars, but as we're finding, is it worth the numbers of layoffs? Is it worth the higher prices for those minimum wage employees, many who frequent with their families minimum wage establishments that are now going to bump those numbers up? So at the end of the day, sure, we all would like a few extra dollars. It's an honorable, righteous focus and goal. We should have a discussion about wages and benefits, but this approach, as we're finding, is going to have even a broader, more dangerous effect and impact on the people we're trying to help here.
We're talking with John Kapitek of the National Federation of Independent Business. He's the state director. Also with us, Joe Sandberg, anti-poverty advocate and the primary financial backer of Proposition 32. It would in stages raise the state minimum wage to $18 an hour, and it would also tie it to the consumer price index, although it would be capped if inflation went up more than 3.5%. 3.5 would be the highest that the hourly wage could be raised in response to inflation. If you have questions for our guests, you can email them at adcomments@las.com. Please include your location and first name. Joe Sandberg, let's talk about where California would be competitively with other states. This would be the highest state minimum wage in the United States. Does that potentially put California in non-service-oriented jobs where you have to be in the same location, so it's not state-to-state competitive? But for jobs such as manufacturing, other jobs, for example, where there is state-to-state competition, does this disadvantage California?
Well, first of all, I'd like to address the point that John made, and that opponents of Prop 32, those who want to keep wages low, continue to repeat, which is that the recent evidence from fast food workers earning the higher minimum wage is that it destroys jobs. And John asked, well, you know, where am I getting the statistics that actually fast food jobs have increased since we raised the minimum wage for fast food workers to $20? And I want to provide the answer. The U.S. Bureau of Labor Statistics reported that 11,000 more fast food jobs exist in California since the minimum wage for fast food workers was increased to $20. In addition, for those listening who are on the right of the political spectrum, that was also reported by Fox Business News, that 11,000 more fast food jobs have been created in California since the minimum wage went to $20. So the U.S. Bureau of Labor Statistics, all the way to Fox Business, have validated that same statistic. Second thing I want to say is this idea that, well, raising the minimum wage will mean a few extra bucks in the pockets of some people. The stakes are much higher than that. We need to take this out of the dry, inhumane statistics and bring it into the real life considerations of the 2 million households who will be earning $3,000 a year or more. They're not using that money to go and buy frivolous things. They're using that money to put food on the table for their kids, where right now they're having to give them two meals a day instead of three. You asked the question of where would California's minimum wage stack up against other states? Well, we need to compare the minimum wage in any state versus the cost of living. And the reality is the California exodus of Californians to neighboring states is primarily working people who are leaving for Nevada, Arizona, and Washington, who have minimum wages that might be a little bit less than California, but whose cost of living is substantially less. And so increasing the minimum wage is a necessity to allow working people to be able to stay in the state of California.
Let's talk about the impact on part-time workers, because you make the argument that if employers are going to be paying more in a minimum wage, they may be less willing to take on part-time workers. They may instead want people for that rate who are working full-time. Could this disadvantage working parents, people like that who need flexible schedules, could this in any way disadvantage them, Joe?
No, it'll mean they're making more money and better able to afford life's basic needs.
Well, if they have a job. But my question is, would they be as likely to have a job?
Well, as we've now validated from both the U.S. Bureau of Labor Statistics and Fox Business News, we have recent evidence of what happens when you raise the minimum wage in the fast food industry, which is you have 11,000 more fast food jobs. Let's talk about this question of how money is distributed when you spend money at a business. First and foremost, the statistics from the Federal Reserve are clear that the amount of money we spend at businesses that go to corporate profits and CEO pay is at an all-time high by a multiple of 7x. So when businesses, and in particular their lobbyists, who are paid to make those businesses more money, talk about wages as somehow the cause of inflation, it's critically important that we remember We have had inflation in a period where corporate profits are at all-time highs by a multiple of seven. So is the problem with inflation wages, or the fact that seven times more than in the past of your money spent at businesses is going to corporate profits and CEO pay? And
again, John, hold on. John Kapitek, you want to respond to that? We're getting tight on time.
Yeah, well, there's always this conversation we hear from the proponents of this and Mr. Sandberg about corporate profits. Again, small businesses make up about 99.2% of all businesses in California. So when we hear about corporate profits and the greed of corporate America, when you go to any community, Glendale, West Hollywood, Sacramento, we are not talking about corporate impact here. We're talking about impact on most businesses, which are small businesses. And I think it's important to point out, you know, only 1.4% of all hourly paid workers are minimum wage workers. This is not impacting the majority of the workforce. And an independent analysis by the state, legislative analyst, has pegged this already in the billions of dollars per state and local governments, which means one of two things. We're going to either be paying more taxes, or likely we're going to see possibly cuts to other important programs, homelessness, healthcare, education. If billions of dollars per year is what we're going to take the hit, it's just like a small business owner. Our state leaders are going to have to either raise prices, meaning taxes, or make cuts. And that's important programs that we all rely on.
I want to thank you both for being with us, John Kapitek, National Federation of Independent Business, Joe Sandberg, the primary financial backer of Proposition 32, which would raise the statewide minimum wage in stages to $18 an hour and tie it to the Consumer Price Index so that it would increase with a cap of 3.5% as the max per year. It's Air Talk on LAist 89.3. Coming up, Beverly Hills Noir, the intersection of a small town, but unlike most other small towns in America, Beverly Hills Noir, crime, sin, and scandal in 90210. We'll talk with journalist Scott Hoover, who's the author of the book, when we come back.
LAist consistently delivers important news to Los Angeles and Orange County.
Hi, I'm Ellie Yu, senior reporter at LAist. I started reporting on nursing homes at the height of the pandemic. Our investigations found a loophole in state law that allowed nursing homes to operate without first getting licenses. And later, we found that people with serious mental illness were funneled into facilities that weren't set up to care for them. Our reporting on nursing homes has caught the attention of legislators who've since changed multiple state laws.
LAist, connecting you to your community.
It's Air Talk. I'm Larry Mantle. Tomorrow on Film Week at 10 o'clock, I'll be joined by critics Tim Cogshell, Wade Major, and Charles Solomon. We'll hear about the documentary that's all told using Lego bricks, piece by piece. It's the life story of singer-songwriter and record producer Pharrell Williams. We'll also hear about the biographical drama The Apprentice, about Donald Trump's early years, Sebastian Stan and Jeremy Strong star, the Japanese anime movie My Hero Academia, You're Next, and the romantic drama We Live in Time, starring Andrew Garfield and Florence Pugh. That's all coming up, along with more films to review tomorrow morning at 10 here on Film Week. But we continue in a Beverly Hills frame of mind. The new book, Beverly Hills Noir, Crime, Sin, Scandal in 90210, is written by Scott Hoover, who's a journalist who both has covered crime and has covered the entertainment industry, and he's brought his two interests together in the new book. Scott, good morning.
Good morning, Larry. Thanks for having me.
I understand you kept some files over your journalistic career, sort of ideas that became the center of the book.
Yeah, I became fascinated with the history of crime in Beverly Hills when I was working at a newspaper there, and assembled sort of these cases that I was really interested in, and over years kind of found little bits and pieces and gradually was creating a little jigsaw puzzle of some of them. And when I had time during the pandemic, I said, I want to really dig into these stories. And it was a blast doing the research and discovering, you know, just how permeated with celebrity Beverly Hills crime is.
Well, and it's a small city surrounded by Los Angeles. It's an island. Is it, what is it, 6 square miles or something? It's
very not even six, yeah.
Yeah, it's very small. Nonetheless, with many famous residents and a lot of intrigue, it's got more than its share of wild crime stories. Let's talk with the one that's that takes place at the famous Doheny Mansion in Beverly Hills, site of many public events over the years. What happened there?
In 1929, it was only maybe 6 months had been open. It was the grandest estate in Southern California, possibly second to San Simeon in the entire state. And the Doheny family were oil rich, probably the wealthiest people in the area. And it was built for Ned Doheny by his father, Edward Doheny. And they were involved in something called the Teapot Dome scandal, which was a bribery situation with the Secretary of Interior for oil rights to government land. And there was some tension swirling around that. And one night, Ned's closest friend and personal secretary kind of stormed up to the mansion and needed to speak with him urgently. And they went to a private room in the mansion. And next thing you know, both men were dead on the floor. And the fascinating thing about it is that there's an official version of the case in which one guy shot the other and then killed himself. And then there's
and that story is that the secretary shot and killed Ned and then killed himself, correct?
That's the official version. But the forensic details, as reported by the LADA's office's investigator at the time, suggests an entirely different scenario, the very reverse of it. And it's such a knotty thing. And it's endured for almost 100 years now, this mystery. So it was really interesting delving into that. And as far as I could determine, it is the very first murder ever to take place in Beverly Hills.
And is this something that it's possible 100 years later to get to the bottom of it to determine what really happened?
At this point, I don't think so. I think that the Doheny money, there's very strong evidence that the family used their power, influence, and money to cover it up at the time, for their own variety of reasons. And it was so thorough at the time, I don't know that there'll ever be any evidence to reveal what the truth is.
And it's one of the possibilities that it would have nothing to do with outward scandal, but it was the relationship of the two men that went awry? Is that a possible explanation?
That is definitely possible. There's long been rumors, ever since I've been around, I've heard these rumors that the two men were always described as incredibly close. And there's been rumors that they were involved with each other romantically, which was, you know, more taboo. The family didn't want that getting out if that was true. And there's a situation involving where they are buried and how close they're buried together, despite this murder-suicide situation, that the family was accommodating that relationship. And I've not been able to find any concrete evidence that says that they were involved or not, but it's a rumor that has persisted for all of these years.
We're talking with Scott Hoover, author of Beverly Hills Noir, Crime, Sin, and Scandal in 90210. One of the other stories you tell centers on the actor Joan Bennett, who was in a number of films in Hollywood's golden era. For a later generation, she was one of the stars of the Dark Shadows gothic soap opera series on ABC. But she was romantically involved with, it was her former agent, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was her agent at the time. Yeah, Jennings Lang. She was married to a very, very respected and successful Hollywood producer, Walter Wanger. But his career had kind of hit a rough patch. He'd worked with people like Hitchcock and pretty much every star that you can imagine back in the golden age of Hollywood. And everything kind of went to hell. And his wife was really the breadwinner for a while, as they were at risk of even losing their home in Holmby Hills. And she was leaning on her agent, Jennings Lang, to keep getting her work. And as they grew closer together, they started an affair. And Wanger had private detectives watching them, learned what they were doing, which was basically she would go to meetings at the agency in Beverly Hills, right across from City Hall. They would adjourn to an apartment that was kept around the corner for one of the clients of the agency, Marlon Brando, who was just making his way into Hollywood at the time and coming back and forth from New York. And they would spend an hour or so there. And one day, Walter Wanger showed up and waited in the parking lot of the MCA building and confronted them and shot Jennings Lang in a very specific portion of his anatomy that was somewhat symbolic. And then as they raced off to try to get him medical attention, Wanger just waited for the police who had heard the gunshot to walk across the street and take him into custody. It's a wild situation.
You've got a photo of Lang in the hospital, lying on a gurney. And I was just wondering, who in the world would allow a photograph like that to be taken?
I loved finding that because it just shows the lengths that the L.A. newspaper men and women of the day would go to get the story, to get the shot. I mean, somebody, I'm sure, slipped somebody some cash to get into that emergency room and take that picture. But I found that in the LA Times archives at UCLA, and I doubt it's been seen since it was published in the paper.
And he's clearly visible. I mean, he's laying, I guess it's actually while he's having surgery, and the doctor is standing over him. You see Lang's face. It's just astonishing that something like that. I mean, can you imagine the hospital, the lawsuit that there would be now with something like that?
Yeah, it would never happen today. I mean, reporters today are persistent, but they're not that persistent.
We're talking with journalist Scott Hoover. His book, Beverly Hills Noir, Crime, Sin, and Scandal in 90210. We'll continue our conversation. He has a number of cases here. It's kind of prime for a sequel because I'm sure these aren't the only wild, noirish kinds of cases in Beverly Hills criminal history. We'll be back in just 1 minute.
On the next Fresh Air, we talk with internationally acclaimed Israeli writer Edgar Keret about his experiences during this past year of war. His family reflects multiple points of view. His parents were Holocaust survivors. His sister was a settler. His brother is left wing. Keret has been calling for a settlement to end the war and release the hostages. Join us. Weekdays at noon on LAist 89.3.
Support for LAist comes from Caltech, presenting Wang Yi and Kuka October 18th and 19th. The art of modern dance meets the science of mechanical engineering in a series of vignettes between live dancers and Kuka, a specially programmed industrial robot. A synthesis of movement and innovation, the work celebrates the future of humanity and technology. Presented in collaboration with Getty's PST Art, with support from the Taiwan Ministry of Culture. Tickets for Wang Yi and Kuka are available at caltech.edu/kuka.
Next hour on Air Talk, we continue our election coverage with Los Angeles County District Attorney George Gascon. He'll be with us in studio next hour on Air Talk. His challenger, Nathan Hochman, was with us just a couple of days ago, so it gives you a chance to hear from both of the DA candidates. In case you missed our interview with the challenger, Nathan Hochman, you can find that at laist.com/vote. Our voter game plan has all of the Air Talk conversations on the ballot measures, on the candidate races, everything there, plus the extraordinary work that our voter game plan staff has done, taking a year and thousands of labor hours, putting together this guide for you on everything in LA and Orange County. It's at laist.com/vote. I really encourage you to check it out. I fall down the rabbit hole of it, and I'm going into all kinds of different things and learning stuff myself, and I've been covering elections for 4 decades, so they've done truly outstanding work. I really recommend it. We continue with Scott Hoover, is the author of Beverly Hills Noir, Crime, Sin, and Scandal in 90210. We were just talking in the break about, even after that incredible scandal that the newspapers were full of and photographs of the principals, that you were saying that both of the men involved, their careers thrived after the event, and Lang physically fully recovered.
Yeah, Walter Wanger went to prison, basically, and came out with an idea to do all of these social reform movies. He did I Want to Live and Riot in Cell Block Number 9, and it revived his career until he did Cleopatra, which undid him because of the adulterous affair of Richard Burton and Elizabeth Taylor on the set that just caused that movie to tank. And then Jennings Lang went on to work for Universal, and shepherded movies to the screen like Earthquake and a lot of the disaster movies of the era. And he had a very vibrant career afterwards. And poor Joan Bennett just really kind of, all she had after that was pretty much Dark Shadows. It's a nice cult hit, but it wasn't even that big a deal at the time.
Yeah, right. It kind of lived on in the reruns afterwards. Let's talk about a huge heist at Van Cleef & Arpels on Rodeo Drive. We've, of course, had in recent years smash-and-grab robberies that have taken place in upscale places like Beverly Hills. But this involved a hostage situation. Take us back to 1986 and this crime.
Yeah, probably the worst crime to take place in Beverly Hills. It was a young, sort of aimless drifter who'd flirted around with crime, not been very successful, walked into the Van Cleef & Arpels jewelry store wearing a business suit, but looking kind of scruffy. And the staff got hip to the fact that he was not up to any good and called the police pretty quickly. And they show up very fast in Beverly Hills. They have they pride themselves on a 3-minute response time.
They don't have far to drive.
That's right. And so he got trapped inside the jewelry boutique, which was kind of impregnable with the security, and couldn't really get out. And the staff was trapped in there with him. And it turned it into a long hostage standoff. And unfortunately, the media found a phone line into the store that the police had not known about and had not shut off, and called in and were kind of working him up. How are you going to get out of there? You're trapped. Do you have a plan? And the more frustrated he got, the more he started to take his frustrations out on the hostages, and people ended up dead. And then when he tried to escape, there was a huge miscommunication with the LA County SWAT team, and one of the hostages was shot dead and others were injured when they threw one of those flashbang grenades that exploded. The one guy who walked out of it was Stephen Levititis, the culprit, and remains to this day on death row.
And you've got a photo of him all bandaged up. I don't know if it's his arraignment or what it is, but he's sitting there with his wounds visible. He's got a tourniquet around his head and his arms all bandaged up, undoubtedly from what happened with his arrest.
Yeah, he was injured within that explosion from the grenades. They hit too close as he was trying to get the hostages out of the store and into the manager's car to drive away. Those grenades hit too close to everybody, and everybody suffered severe burns.
Scott, we only have a minute left. I do want to ask real quickly about the Rat Pack event at the Polo Lounge at the Beverly Hills Hotel, because it's like quintessential Beverly Hills.
Such a great story. Dean Martin's birthday, Frank and Dean are out at the Polo Lounge, the swankiest watering hole in town, and things are getting a little salty. Some racial epithets got thrown around between them and some neighboring millionaires that were visiting. Some punches were thrown, and somebody ended up on the floor unconscious. And what was interesting about it is it was kind of a Rashomon kind of story. Everybody told a different version of what had happened. And it took.
There might have been drinking involved.
A little bit of drinking on everybody's part. And, Sinatra and Dean both fled in different directions while the police tried to sort things out. And the millionaire on the floor, Frederick Wiseman, an art collector, very, very renowned art collector in Los Angeles, he was comatose for quite a while, and everybody was very concerned for his health and for what was going to happen to Sinatra's career. And everything blew over. He recovered. There may have been some money exchanged here and there. But the truth of the story has only trickled out over decades as to who did what. And it was one of Sinatra's friends, one of his basically his de facto bodyguard, Jilly Rizzo, that took one of those pink phones in the Polo Lounge and clobbered Wiseman over that.
We did our AirTalk 20th anniversary event there, and we had nothing like that. It was so calm.
Invite me next time.
Yeah, that's right. Should have taken Jilly Rizzo. Thanks so much, Scott. I appreciate it. Really enjoyed it. Beverly Hills Noir, Crime, Sin, and Scandal in 90210. Scott Hoover, the author of the book. It's AirTalk on LAist 89.3.
This week on Imperfect Paradise, artist and co-founder of Black Lives Matter, Patrice Cullors, on what she thinks is at stake in this year's presidential election.
Kamala Harris has been put into a seat that is incredibly historic, not just because she may be the first Black woman president.
And she reflects on the current state of the Black Lives Matter movement.
What happens when the community actually moves to the center or the right of the conversation?
Patrice Cullors on Imperfect Paradise, wherever you get your podcasts.
Good morning, it's Air Talk. I'm Larry Mantle. TV Talk coming up, and it's a brand new season of the terrific Abbott Elementary, Season 4. We'll hear what our TV critics have to say about it later this hour. Also remind you, we have a sweepstakes on right now for 4 Loge-level tickets to Dodger Stadium tomorrow at 5 for first pitch, the deciding game of the National League Divisional Series between the Dodgers and the Padres. You might be the lucky winner of 4 Loge-level tickets to Dodger Stadium tomorrow afternoon, evening. To be a winner, to be entered to win, all you need to do is go to LAIST.com/give and make a contribution in any amount. You are entered in the sweepstakes. That's LAIST.com/give. Good luck to you. Hopefully you'll be at Dodger Stadium tomorrow evening to root the team on against the San Diego Padres. We continue our election coverage this hour with L.A. County D.A. George Gascon. He'll be with us in just a few minutes. But we begin the hour with County Measure G for Los Angeles County residents. This would expand the Board of Supervisors from the current 5 to 9 members. It would create an elected executive who would be elected countywide. It would also create an ethics commission and would require that the departments within the county present their budgets in public sessions with the Board of Supervisors. Joining us is proponent for Measure G, the chair of the L.A. County Board of Supervisors, Lindsay Horvath. Supervisor, thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me. Good morning.
It's so unusual for an elected body to choose to do anything that would dilute its power, and that's what the majority of the board has done here. First of all, why do you think it's so important to expand to 9 members?
So we've heard it is long overdue. This change is much needed to make LA County work for the people it governs. And these are changes that have been studied for decades, more than 50 years, in fact. And yet we haven't had the opportunity to consider all of these changes in one comprehensive package, which is what Angelenos have been calling for. And so we're bringing forward this package, as you outlined, with that and a few more details to really open up the conversation. This government hasn't been changed since 1912, when there were more cows than people in Los Angeles County. So we know it's time for change. We want a government that meets the moment in the 21st century and actually delivers for the people.
And why include all these different moving parts in a single measure?
We know that some of these pieces have been tried as one-off solutions to the problems that have been plaguing LA County for decades. And they haven't passed because any one of these things alone isn't the solution. Truly transforming Los Angeles County government requires us to take a look at all of these measures together and put it together in one package, so that way we can make sure that LA County is shifting in all the ways that it needs to change. And what we have done in this charter amendment is not just put a whole bunch of things together that get thrown in, at the flip of a switch. We have thoughtfully structured how these changes will be implemented with deadlines, so that way people know that the change that they're voting for, which will be a public process going forward overseen by the Ethics Reform Task Force, a process that they can be a part of and have their voice be heard in, that process will actually lead to outcomes, unlike some of the charter reform efforts that we have seen, where years and years of discussion have, in hopes of getting to that quote unquote perfect solution to put on the ballot. You know, we have seen that often these efforts lead to things being kicked down, the can being kicked down the road. And instead, this charter amendment delivers change, it structures it with deadlines, and gives the public the opportunity to have a voice in how those changes are made.
We're talking with Los Angeles County Supervisor Lindsay Horvath. She chairs the Board of Supervisors. She represents the 3rd District, which is a coastal swath in far northwest Los Angeles County, then comes down, crosses into the San Fernando Valley, and all the way to Hollywood. 10 cities, 26 unincorporated communities, and 49 neighborhoods are included in her district. She's proponent of Measure G, expanding the Board of Supervisors from 5 to 9 supes. It would also add a countywide elected executive. And Supervisor Horvath, would that be like a county mayor, or would this countywide elected executive have a different function?
That's exactly right. We already have a mayor in the city of Los Angeles, so we didn't want to call it a mayor, but that's exactly how the function is, separating out the executive authority that currently exists within the Board of Supervisors and creating a separate branch of government. Right now, the Board of Supervisors is the executive, the legislative, and a quasi-judicial body for all of the 10 million residents of Los Angeles County. And that has led to many of the transformational changes that this board has proposed getting stuck inside the county bureaucracy through institutional inertia. And what we are trying to do is create a check and balance that exists in every other level of government in our country. And in fact, when we brought forward this motion, we heard from the experts that this county government is the only one of its kind on the planet. And that's why we've seen the problems in delivering the results that people have been expecting from LA County.
And in the city of Los Angeles, it's described as a strong council, weak mayor, although Mayor Bass certainly has some areas like, you know, choosing the chief of police subject to ratification by the council, which is a major responsibility. How would you see this countywide elected person being on that scale of strong versus weak mayor to council?
Well, the way this charter amendment has balanced these two branches of government is really sort of a check and balance on each other. The elected executive would have the authority to hire department directors subject to confirmation by the Board of Supervisors. They would have the authority to fire department directors, but the board would also have, by a 2/3 vote, the ability to reinstate them if they wanted to keep that person in leadership. The elected executive, and this piece I think is critical, would draft the county's proposed budget. That budget would have to be confirmed, of course, by the Board of Supervisors, as we currently do. But having that budget drafted by somebody who is elected by the people and who is responsible to the priorities that the people set. Right now, we have a $49 billion budget in Los Angeles County that needs a public process and led by somebody who is accountable to the public.
Who drafts the budget now for the county?
Right now, the county CEO drafts the budget, and she drafts it in a way in which the department directors work with her behind the scenes. And then there are 3 stages of budget presentations. That's not how a $49 billion budget should work, especially when we're talking about social safety net services for the region. What this charter amendment would require is that those department directors actually have to present their budget proposals publicly and bring all of this conversation out from the shadows and behind closed doors and out into the public where it belongs. We have heard time after time from the public that, you know, just having 1 minute to comment at on a budget of $40 billion that has so many different needs and issues to address, it's just not a fair and equitable way for people to engage in this conversation. We need to transform how we talk about and how we make decisions around the dollars that are being spent on our public.
I don't mean to be disrespectful in asking this comment, but I'm serious. How do you avoid grandstanding elected officials in that budget presentation process who are catering to particular interests or want to get a soundbite that goes viral on social media, and that not really doing the best job for the public in dealing with the priorities of the budget and its ultimate approval?
Right now, we have 5 elected officials who get to speak their minds about the budget. I don't think anybody's complaining about elected officials saying where those dollars should be spent and how they should be prioritized. In fact, what we have seen is that the public would like to have more of a say in how those dollars are being spent, not less of a say. And when we see the chronic issues ranging from homelessness to criminal justice reform, to the issues that we've seen in our probation halls and camps, and so many other issues, you know, these are chronic issues that the board has brought forward very creative solutions in the motions that have been presented and passed. And then we see years of delay in terms of implementing any sort of change, you know, and the inefficiencies of some of the systems that exist, like our homelessness services system, for example, where people have rightly asked many questions about how their dollars are being spent, to what end, and what measurable outcomes. When five people are in charge, nobody's really in charge. And right now, the CEO in the county is a CEO in name only. She does not hire and fire. She does not have the authority to manage departments. All of that performance evaluation happens through the Board of Supervisors. And so if you're a department director trying to set a vision, or more importantly, trying to solve a problem that manifests in real time, you have to then walk the eighth floor, as they say, and go to five different offices, hoping that those individual conversations amount to a solution that makes sense. When you can only make decisions in an executive level by convening the five of us at any one given moment, it's wildly inefficient and leads to a lack of clarity and vision.
We're talking with Lindsay Horvath, the chair of the Los Angeles County Board of Supervisors. She's proponent of Measure G, which would expand the five-member Board of Supervisors to 9 SUPs. It would also add this countywide elected executive and would create an ethics commission for the county and also require that the departmental budgets be presented in public with the supervisors. The budget would be drafted by the chief executive, elected countywide, as you just heard from Supervisor Horvath. On Monday, we'll be talking with a colleague of Supervisor Horvath. Supervisor Holly Mitchell will be with us. She has concerns about the cost of this. Supervisor Horvath, what about all the additional field offices, the staffing that would be in addition to this, paying the supervisors themselves as well as the countywide elected executive? How much extra is this going to cost county taxpayers?
It's actually not going to cost the county taxpayers anything additional. In fact, that's written into the charter amendment that we cannot raise taxes in order to implement these changes. And my colleague did bring forward a motion that this board unanimously supported to ask our auditor controller to evaluate the fiscal impact of how this charter amendment has been proposed. And it's included in the ballot language that went out to folks in Los Angeles County. And his estimate was about $8 million to implement these changes. That, you know, while it is a very significant number, and out of a $49 billion budget, it is not the financial impact that people fear. In fact, I think it will lead to many more efficiencies that that people are longing for in terms of how their dollars are being spent in the services that I mentioned before. But what we also know is that currently the Board of Supervisors has, there's hundreds of millions of dollars being spent on the Board of Supervisors offices already. There are hundreds of positions within the existing CEO's office that are unclassified. And so we know that there are positions, there is money, and in terms of the administration that's already happening in the county, what we need is a restructure. This is not bloating government. This is making it work better for the people, bringing it closer to the people that it serves, and making sure that that the residents, especially those who are in the unincorporated areas, are able to better access their government, because the supervisors are not only the social safety net for our unincorporated areas. We also serve effectively as the mayors for our unincorporated areas, and those municipal services deserve to be, the residents deserve to have those services delivered in a meaningful way.
Supervisor, just final question for you. If Measure G is passed by county voters, when would it be implemented and how would it relate to redistricting?
So, as I mentioned earlier, there are several timelines in this charter amendment. And one thing that would happen immediately is, as I said, the department directors will start to present their budgets publicly as part of the next budget cycle. So some of those changes will be implemented immediately. And I think having a closer eye on our budgets by the public is a very important start. By 2026, the Independent Ethics Commission will be up and running. By 2028, the elected executive will be on the ballot for county voters to consider. And then with the next redistricting process that begins in 2030, that's when the board expansion would start to take place, with the first election in 2032 having those seats.
Thank you so much, Supervisor Lindsay Horvath. We appreciate you being with us this morning.
Thank you.
She chairs the L.A. County Board of Supervisors, speaking in support of Measure G, expanding the County Board of Supervisors from 5 to 9, creating a countywide executive, and creating an ethics commission as well. We'll hear an opposition argument on Measure G Monday with L.A. County Supervisor Holly Mitchell. That's coming up on Monday. Next, we're with Los Angeles County District Attorney George Gascon, who's running for his second term, facing challenger Nathan Hochman, who was with us just a few days ago. Back with the DA in just a minute. It's Air Talk on LA's 89.3. I'm Larry Mantle. In just a few minutes, our TV critics will be with us to talk about what's new, including a documentary on the Menendez brothers, appropriate because we have Los Angeles County District Attorney George Gascon with us, who held a news conference just a few days ago to say that there is going to be a fresh look at evidence in that case and how allegations of molestation of the brothers might factor into potential. DA George Gascon, thank you very much for joining us today. We appreciate it.
My pleasure. Good morning, Larry. How you doing?
I'm doing well. Just real quickly on the Menendez case, what's the timeline for the reexamination?
Yes, you know, so this started about a year ago. Initially, they just asked for what is called a habeas, which is actually just basically there's new evidence that should be presented that was not presented to the jury. And then they more recently, earlier this year, they presented a petition for resentencing. There are two different tracks. The habeas is coming up on November 29th in the court hearing, and we're reviewing the resentencing, which is resentencing really is based on California law that says, you know, somebody has been in prison for a very long time, they've rehabilitated, should they be reintegrated in society? Now, either way, you know, it has to be approved by a judge, by a court. So we're reviewing both tracks, and we'll come up with a decision, hopefully shortly.
Let's talk generally about the reform effort that you've led during your first term as district attorney in Los Angeles County. You've made some changes along the way. You've allowed some of your deputy DAs to add sentencing enhancing in some cases. You've even raised the possibility of some minors being prosecuted as adults, although there's a high threshold for that in California. What's changed you? What's led you to make those changes in your approach to some of these cases?
Well, there are multiple things, but the main things, number one, you know, when I first get into office, I did not have a team, right? I wanted to put a team that I felt comfortable, that the things that I was elected on, there were promises to the public that we adhered to them, and if there were going to be exceptions, that the exceptions would not swallow the rule. So that's number one. Number two, I've had a lot of conversations, not only internally, but externally, you know, areas of concern. And as we improve our practice, you know, we now have good vehicles to review those exceptional cases. And, you know, like you talk about gun enhancements, you know, we have now done somewhere around 15,000 gun enhancements in the last 3 years. But, you know, significantly less than it used to be done because we're very tailored. If you're using a gun to commit a crime, and, you know, the gun was a tool of the crime, then we will look at enhancements. But on the other hand, if you were in possession of a gun, if you had a gun around you, you know, where the office before would definitely seek those enhancements that were extremely punitive and not necessarily connected to the reality of the safety. When it came to hate crimes, I changed that immediately because people said, look, people that I knew well says, we know that enhancements don't necessarily reduce crime, but the message at a moment when hate crimes are going up is not a good message. So we did that too. When it comes even to juveniles being transferred, you know, I'm very against it in very general terms. And as you indicated, the threshold is very high. There were only 5 juveniles transferred in the entire state last year. But I want to provide the opportunity, if there is an exceptional case, where the juvenile clearly cannot be rehabilitated in the juvenile system, and the crime was very serious, that we have the capacity to evaluate if that person should be transferred to adult court.
Let's talk about the juvenile case. The Los Angeles Times reporting about a week ago the case of Shanice Dyer, who was the 17-year-old, committed a double homicide, allegedly as member of the Crips gang group in South Los Angeles, served some time, and then shortly upon release is now charged with another homicide. And she was 17 years old, and you prosecuted her through the juvenile system as opposed to an adult, so the sentence ended up being less. You've made the argument that because the human brain doesn't really become an adult, so to speak, until the mid-20s, that we need to take that into account in fairness to the young person who can potentially be rehabilitated. But the flip side of that argument is if you have someone engaging in highly violent activity as a late teenager, and their brain isn't going to be more developed, the prefrontal cortex, till the mid-20s, does it make sense to have that person released before the brain development is done?
Yeah, well, look, I mean, there's a lot to unpack. So first of all, you know, because of the confidentiality around juvenile cases, we cannot talk about the case in particular, but let me give you a hypothetical. You know, we often are looking at cases where you have people that have been the victims or are being the victims of human traffic. They're being forced to do things under duress. They've had a conditions in their life that have created a situation where they are being forced into doing things that they would not do otherwise. Those things are also part of the equation when we're looking at a particular case, and they also influence the way a decision is made. When you're talking about this particular case, for instance, now moving to the case without getting into the specifics of the case, there are five factors that we have to look under the law in order to transfer somebody. Those factors are basically the severity of the crime, but then the other four factors really deal with, can this juvenile in general be rehabilitated within the juvenile system? Is there enough time to do so? Those, if you cannot overcome those, the transfer will not occur. Now, the threshold for those five factors now has been increased even higher to what is called a basically like a 75% likelihood that that could not occur. So the reality is that even under the old law, many experts said that, you know, this juvenile would not have been transferred, but certainly under the new laws, it almost an impossibility, right, as a juvenile. Now, the release part of it, which we don't necessarily control, also under the law, if the juvenile is rehabilitating during their stay and they're responding to treatment, they actually get their sentence to be shortened and they get released early. This particular juvenile was rehabilitating. She was going to school. She was doing all the things that she was being asked to do. Unfortunately, she came back out and again, you know, fell into the life of gangs. And, you know, there's a very complicated case here. You have there all people that were involved in criminal activity. And, you know, and this was a revenge killing, and we understand all of that. It doesn't make, obviously, it's a horrible loss, right? But we have to understand how the system works and how we got there.
My point is that if you have someone at this age who has, even if it's found that this individual's under the control of a gang and heavily influenced by other people to commit the crime, wouldn't you have to show that that person upon release is far less likely to be influenced by people similarly as the person was influenced when they were younger before they were sentenced? And it, I mean, in a case like this, did that even happen?
Well, the problem is that what the law does is the law is, again, I said there are five factors. And the primary driver of these factors is, can, and this is done by the probation department and the court, can this person be rehabilitated within the juvenile system, and is there enough time? A 17-year-old has until they're about 25. In this particular case, the report from the probation department and the court determined that this person could be rehabilitated within the system, and she went into the system and gave all the appearance of having been rehabilitated, and then things went sideways.
And you're saying that that's unpredictable. You can't determine that. And you have to release if the person shows the progress while they're in custody.
Well, and you know, and that, I don't have to release it. It's the system, no, I understand, right? Yeah, the law requires that that occurs, yes.
And that's independent of your prosecution, you're saying.
Absolutely.
We're talking with Los Angeles County District Attorney George Gascon. Let's talk about gun enhancements, because you mentioned that when you arrived to lead the office that essentially gun enhancements were being slapped onto every prosecution, even if the gun had nothing to do with the crime that was being committed. But couldn't you have given that direction to the deputy DA, say, look, as opposed to not charging in any gun enhancements for these crimes, we are only going to charge when the gun is directly involved in the crime itself, as opposed to the blanket policy you did enact?
Well, you know, again, you have to go back to the moment, and you have to go back to the team that I had, and I wanted to make sure that the things that I was elected on, which is really the, you know, the reduction, almost elimination of all enhancements, because they have been proven not to work, by the way. A lot of data that shows that all enhancements do is add more time to prison time, not necessarily deter the crime from occurring in the first place. I wanted to make sure that we had that in place first, and that then we begin to adjust, and that's what we have done, and we will continue to do that. If I am honored with another 4 years by the voters, we will continue to evolve. There is new knowledge coming in each and every day. You know, our profession, as any other profession, should never be static, right? The problem that we've had from before is we had blanket policies before, which, by the way...
But you put blanket policies in yourself.
May I finish, please?
Sure.
Yeah, we have blanket policies before, right, that basically said we will go the maximum in every case, whatever we can, regardless of the necessity to do so. Becoming the most carceral county in the country per capita, you know, seeking the death penalty, seeking transfer kids to adult court regularly, a lot of things that were clearly not working because our crime was going up, right? I was elected on a very clear platform. And that platform will evolve, and it's evolving. But look, I mean, you're looking right now, for instance, at my opponent, right? He says he will prosecute every crime to the fullest. Well, that is a blanket policy that basically says we are going back to mass incarceration, right? He says, I will use the death penalty on the most horrendous cases. Well, guess what? The most horrendous cases are the ones that generally have the public pressure for police and prosecutors to deliver a result, and that is where wrongful convictions occur, right? He's talking about he will make sure that people stay in prison for their full term. Well, he knows that he doesn't control how long people will stay in prison, because that is not what DAs have control over. So, you know, we have an individual that is running on blanket policies and is also lying to the public.
Well, but District Attorney, I want to ask you about the what leverage the prosecutors have when it comes to someone staying behind bars, because you've had victims' advocacy groups that have been critical that they've gone into the parole hearings for people involved with the death of a family member, and that there have not been anyone from your office who've gone alongside them into those hearings, something that they claim, at least under your predecessor, used to occur. So would that not be a case where your office would have some leverage to potentially keep someone in prison longer?
So I am so pleased that you asked that, because first of all, what they're saying is we're not sending a lawyer with them. We're sending a victim advocate. By the way the system is supposed to work, parole is a presumption of the law, right? Unless you get sentenced to life without the possibility of parole, there is a presumption that at some point, if you rehabilitate, you will be released. A very small number of people get released, certainly in the first time around, is a very difficult process, under 20%. But the role of the parole board is not to look at the past crime only. They look at that, and they have that information. There was a conviction, right? The role is to look at whether the person has rehabilitated, and are they safe to be reintegrated in society, and then to see what impact would that have on the victim. And the Department of Correction actually has a whole system of advocacy that they provide assistance to people in order to prepare to provide a victim's impact statement to the Board of Parole if they desire to do so. By the way, one of the things that we found, we did a poll of victims of violent crime in the county. We didn't. People did a poll right before I became the elected DA. And overwhelmingly, people felt that we were not dealing with their trauma and that we were not necessarily attending to their needs because we were so concerned about the prosecution.
This is under your predecessor.
Under my predecessor. So one of the things that I did is I actually asked the U.S. Department of Justice to do an audit of victim service. They came up with a whole bunch of recommendations. We also created a victim's advisory board that is composed of men and women that were themselves either the victims of violent crime or they lost someone to violent crime. And the recommendations, for instance, included not only that we do not automatically tell everybody about the parole board, that we let people self-select themselves. By the way, the system, people that want to be notified, they are told that they can register themselves and they will get notified.
For when the parole hearing occurs.
Exactly, if it ever occurs, because for many people, they don't want to be re-traumatized. You know, 20, 30 years later, they don't want to deal with this anymore. So, but those that want to, right, they want to be notified, they should. So we actually, as a result of the law and our Victims Advisory Board, we created a mechanism to notify those that are saying we want to be notified. We're providing service through victim advocates. We're actually moved away from having a lawyer running our victim services, which was one of the recommendations of the advisory board. So we want a clinician. We put a clinician there. We have gone to hire additional 30 people, advocates, and we've gone through extensive training on trauma-informed care. But going back to your original question on the parole board, let me finish. The job of the parole board is to evaluate, can this person be released back into society safely? Have they rehabilitated? And this is under the presumption of the law. Sending a prosecutor there to argue the original crime that the person is convicted is somewhat redundant because the board has that. But I tell you, actually, interestingly enough, and that's not the motivation here for me, when you look at the results of when you have prosecutors at parole hearings, actually an insignificant number, but actually less people are likely to be held back when there is a prosecutor according to CDCR numbers and when prosecutors are there. So really, it doesn't have an impact on that other than, you know, it's become a political football.
We're talking with Los Angeles County District Attorney George Gascon. You mentioned earlier that using enhancements to prosecute cases doesn't prove to be a deterrent. No one, when they're committing a crime, or few people are considering, gosh, I can get a gun enhancement or a gang enhancement or whatever the extra sentencing might be. So if we see that that's the case, that it's not a deterrent, then you can also argue that in adding an enhancement, it keeps someone who's a threat to society behind bars for a longer period of time. In other words, that there is a public safety, even if it doesn't have a deterrent effect. So my question for you is, do you think that there is not a benefit in potentially keeping people behind bars for a longer period if they've shown they're highly antisocial?
Look, I mean, it's a case-by-case analysis generally, but, you know, we could warehouse entire communities and that will be safe. I mean, you got totalitarian countries are often very safe because they put a lot of people in prison. So it's a social question, right? It's a governance question, right? We live in a democracy where we have different presumptions, right? When we look at countries that are similarly situated to ours, I'm talking about developed democracies around the world, the way that they address the accountability part of sending somebody to prison is really based on the safety at the moment and the evaluation through the process of when a person gets incarcerated. There is tremendous amount of evidence that increased terms of prison increase recidivism and criminality. Obviously, on the other end of the spectrum, somebody's in prison for the rest of their life or 40, 50 years, that becomes irrelevant. But most people do not go to prison for those periods of time. They're going to prison for 3, 5, 10 years. And there is a lot of evidence that says that in the early stages, almost every time you add another year, you're actually adding the likelihood that this person is going to reoffend. So sending somebody to prison is about accountability. It's about public safety. And it's an evaluation where there are many pieces involved. There is no question there are some people that need to be warehoused for longer periods of time, and we're using the enhancements in those cases that we believe so. But just to simply go wantonly and apply the enhancements across the board has proven to be ineffective and is socially and economically broken.
We have just a couple minutes yet left, and I wanted to ask you about any regrets you might have had, particularly your early months on the job, you lost tremendous support from your deputy DAs with a vote of no confidence. You have made significant changes on the enhancement and other policies during your tenure in your first 4 years. As you look back, what do you think are things, if you had it to do over again, you would do differently?
Yeah, you know what? I did not know how to navigate the world COVID and have enough communication. There's no question that one of the biggest problems that I had was there was not enough communications between myself and my staff. And, you know, because we're 22 branches, it's a very, very vast piece of real estate that we cover. I found myself visiting offices where there were only three or four people, where there should have been 20, 30, 40. I never aggressively enough thought to find ways to do Zoom and other things on a more regular basis with more people. If I had to do it all over again, I would definitely seek a different level of communication. And also, I think that I was never aggressively enough out talking to the media and looking for the ways that I could communicate at a time when we could not communicate with people in person. So that was my bad. It was a, you know, major communication deficiency in the early stages, and one that I have tried to correct and will continue to work to correct that if I were honored with another re-election.
Do you also think, in the fact that you emphasize so much reform of the justice system and what you thought was the unfairness of mass incarceration, that you didn't talk as much about what people were going through in terms of being victims of crime? Do you think that the balance, the tone that you used in talking about the criminal justice system could have been tweaked in any way?
I mean, look, hindsight is always 20/20. But one of the things that we did from the very first advisory board that I put together, and that was in panel within 4 weeks of my being in office, was the Victims Advisory Board. And we did so much early on to improve the quality of our service to victims. Unfortunately, again, this has become a political football, and I get it, you know, but could I have done better communicating? I readily admit that, you know, in many fronts, right? And yes, I probably could have done a little better in this area, but I think that we were doing it. It just wasn't, it was being drowning by the political noise and a lot of the other things.
Thank you so much, District Attorney George Gascon. We appreciate you being with us.
My pleasure, Larry.
Thanks
Thank
very
you.
Much. Running for re-election for a second 4-year term as County District Attorney, Nathan Hochman is the challenger. We interviewed him a few days ago. You can find that interview at LAist.com/vote or at LAist.com/airtalk. It's both places. That interview, as well as today's, are a part of our voter game plan. All the interviews we do on the ballot propositions, the local measures, the candidates' race, explanations of the voting process, how to get registered, where to go to vote. All of that is our voter game plan. You won't find anything else like it. It's at laist.com/vote. Coming up, our television critics. It's a big week, including season 4 of Abbott Elementary. Back in 90 seconds. Also on the voter game plan at laist.com/vote, you'll find the 4-episode podcast, Imperfect Paradise, The DA, including interviews with George Gascon and with Nathan Hochman. Frank Stoltz, the host of Imperfect Paradise's 4-part series, The District Attorney. Well, it's now time to talk television with critics Jen Chaney of Vulture and Whitney Friedlander, who's a freelance entertainment writer. We begin with season 4 of Abbott Elementary. You just heard the theme of the terrific series, which boasts quite the cast, led by the creator of the series, Quinta Brunson. Jen, what do you think about season 4?
Well, this show is just one of the consistently best comedies on broadcast television and just shows overall. It's very, very funny. We've only seen the first 2 episodes of the season. The first one premiered last night and they've given the second one to critics, so I haven't seen too much yet. But what I have seen, I really appreciated. If anybody watched last night, you know that one of the ongoing storylines is going to be about Quinta Brunson's character, Janine, and her relationship with Gregory, who's played by Tyler James Williams, as they
kind of embark on a new chapter in that relationship and also trying to be co-workers. And then, you know, this show does a great job of weaving in social issues. And based on the first two episodes, it seems like one of the big ones is there's a golf course being built near the school and it starts being very disruptive. But they talk to one of the developers and he's sort of offering them like laptops and like, maybe we can sweeten things for you guys. So there's this kind of balance of they hate the golf course, but they also kind of love the golf course. And so I think the idea of like gentrification is going to be a running theme this season.
They're never going to run out of ideas for an elementary school. It's just a font of material. And I assume Janelle James is there as well, who obviously one of the highlights of Abbott Elementary.
Absolutely. She plays the principal, Ava Coleman. And as always, Ava is doing the wrong thing, thinking about herself before thinking about the kids.
Just a great character.
She's a great character, and Janelle James plays her so, so beautifully. Everybody on this show is great. Yeah. I mean, and Cheryl Lee Ralph, who plays Barbara, the very religious and kind of traditionalist teacher, she's a riot. Like, and they've been doing this now, like you said, this is the fourth season, and they all have a really good comfort level and good rhythm with each other. And it's just, you like these characters so much that you just like watching them interact with each other.
They've really captured lightning in a bottle. Terrific scripts, a gifted cast. Abbott Elementary, fourth season on ABC Network and streaming on Hulu. There'll be 22 episodes of the fourth season, and the first premiered last night. Sweet Pea is on Stars. It's a comedic drama miniseries from the UK starring Ella Purnell and Jeremy Swift, created by Kirsty Swain. Whitney, what do you think of Sweet Pea?
This show is nothing like Abbott Elementary, which, depending on where you stand on things, maybe is a good thing or a bad thing. It's one of the shows that we've seen a lot. It's one in a trend of shows we've seen a lot lately where it's woman is overlooked or fed up and she takes revenge or decides to act on her own. And this one, Ella Purnell, who people probably know from like horror adjacent projects like Yellow Jackets or Army of the Dead and Fallout, she plays like a wallflower, kind of pushover, still has lots of issues with people who bullied her in high school, who she starts getting confidence again when she maybe goes on a life of crime. So like if you liked Kevin Kenneth himself or Dead to Me or Bad Sisters or anything like that, you'd probably like this one too. And also you get to hear Ella Purnell speak in her traditional accent.
Sweet Pea is on the Stars app and it airs tomorrow on Stars Channel. The series is rated TVMA. When we continue, we'll hear about the Netflix documentary, The Menendez Brothers. We'll also hear about the Apple TV Plus mystery miniseries, Disclaimer, starring Cate Blanchett and Kevin Kline, Sacha Baron Cohen in the cast, Alfonso Cuarón. The terrific filmmaker is the creator and director of all episodes of the series. We'll hear about that when we come back in 1 minute.
I'm Thipa Fernandez. We meet a Michigan family split over who to vote for in the presidential election. The war in Gaza is a big factor.
I don't think the Democrats have earned my vote because of their policies. I have no doubt that Donald Trump would make things worse. And so I don't think he can have my vote.
That's next time, here and now. Weekdays at 11 on LAist 89.3.
Support for LAist comes from the USC Pacific Asia Museum, presenting Saiguo Cheng, A Material Odyssey, in partnership with the Getty and PST Art. For several decades, artist Saiguo Cheng has used gunpowder and pyrotechnics to create drawings, paintings, and daytime fireworks events. Filling the first floor galleries, the exhibition explores the nature and properties of gunpowder and chronicles its use by the artist, now on view. For more information, visit pacificasiamuseum.usc.edu.
It's Air Talk. I'm Larry Mantle. TV Talk with our critics Whitney Friedlander and Jen Chaney. We have to pick up the pace a little bit. I realize we've got so much more to talk about. Jen, please tell us about the new documentary on the Menendez brothers.
That is the name of the documentary. It's called The Menendez Brothers. It dropped on Netflix on Monday, and it's coming just a few weeks after the Ryan Murphy series Monsters, Eric and Lyle Menendez story debuted and has been really widely watched. That was a scripted series based on the case. This is an actual documentary which features audio interviews from prison with both of the brothers talking about the case for the first time in many, many years. And, you know, it's very blatantly biased toward the brothers. It's really taking the side that the defense that they offered in their original trial, where they said they were abused for the course of their entire childhood, pretty much by their father, really retaking that into much more serious consideration. And, you know, as we've seen in what's been happening in real life, that's what's happening too. The district attorney's office, you were just talking to George Gascon, has kind of reopened the case based on some new evidence that's come out related to Jose Menendez and the possibility that he molested other people as well. So it's an old case, but it's somehow still current.
Alejandro Hartman is the director of the documentary The Menendez Brothers, streaming on Netflix, along with the Ryan Murphy true crime drama series Monsters, the Lyle and Eric Menendez story. Disclaimer on Apple TV Plus from the acclaimed director Alfonso Cuarón, starring Kate Blanchett, Kevin Kline, and Sacha Baron Cohen. Whitney.
Yeah, that's quite a cast, huh?
Yeah, and quite a director.
Quite a director, too. So disclaimer is one of those things where it's like different stories molding into each other. So if you are someone who maybe a little slow about something like that or may need more time, take your time with it. It's okay. You'll figure it out. I will also say that if nothing else, it adds to our year of Cats and Prestige miniseries. We already had that with Ripley. Now we have disclaimers, Cats make full attention to. All the acting is particularly brilliant, but obviously, of course, the cat is the standout.
Okay. What do you think, Jen, of disclaimer?
Well, first, I want to echo what Whitney just said, that this has been the year of the cat, not just on television, but just in general. Cat ladies, a lot of movies with prominent cats. It's a very big cat year. I was really drawn into this. I think what Whitney was alluding to was the idea that there's several storylines initially. There's Cate Blanchett finding this book that seems to be telling some secrets about her life, and she doesn't know who the source of the book is. And then there's Kevin Kline's character who's mourning the loss of his wife. And then there's these flashbacks that we keep seeing, and you're not sure at first how all of these things connect to each other, but the show slowly reveals that. And I got really drawn into it. You know, as was already said, it's very, very well acted. And once you get drawn into, like, what is the mystery, what is really going on here, you kind of want to just keep watching.
Disclaimer on Apple TV Plus, rated TVMA. The first two episodes debut tomorrow. There'll be a total of seven of them. They release weekly. La Machina is about the world of boxing, and it's the first Hulu Spanish language series that they themselves, I believe, have produced. Diego Luna, Gael Garcia Bernal co-star in the series. Marco Ramirez is the creator of it. It's a mini series. Jen, please tell us about La Machina.
First of all, it's so wonderful to see Diego Luna and Gael Garcia Bernal on screen together again. Obviously, they were in Y Tu Mamá También, they're producing partners. They've been in some other projects, but they've also been friends literally since they were babies. So there's just a comfort level. You immediately believe, oh yeah, these guys, that the characters they're playing have known each other for a long time, because that just comes across. Bernal plays a boxer whose nickname is La Máquina, and his manager is Diego Luna's character, and he wants him to just do one more fight. But unfortunately, Diego Luna's character owes some money to some people who are a little bit shady, and things start to get more dangerous and more complicated as the show continues. I thought it was really compelling. I haven't seen the finale because they only gave us 5 out of the 6 episodes in advance. But again, I think the real drawing point for this is seeing Luna and Bernal together again.
I really want to see this. La Machina is streaming on Hulu. It's unrated. Finally, Whitney, please tell us about the comedy special Rachel Bloom, Death, Let Me Do My Special on Netflix.
Right. So Rachel Bloom, if People don't know who she is. She was one of the co-creators of the musical comedy Crazy Ex-Girlfriend. She's also a native Los Angeles person, so that's nice. And it is a comedy special in a very, very dark sense of the word. She is singing songs and talking and making us laugh about death and survivor's remorse and parental responsibilities. For people who don't know Rachel Bloom's backstory, she had a daughter just as COVID hit. And then like a few weeks later, she lost her partner in music writing, Adam Schlesinger. So she kind of was hit with this 1-2 punch of like survival. And she made a whole musical about it. And she toured it around Los Angeles and some other places as well. So you might have seen it live, but if you didn't see it live or if you want to see it again, it is on Netflix.
All right, Rachel Bloom, Death, Let Me Do My Special, streaming on Netflix, directed by Seth Barish. The special releases Tuesday of next week, October 15th. My thanks to our TV critics, Jen Chaney of Vulture and Whitney Friedlander joining us. I also want to take this opportunity to thank our tremendous AirTalk team, led by senior producer Matt D'Angelo-Antonio. Our producers are Lindsay Wright, Lucy Kopp, Manny Valladares, and Peyton Seda. This week, we had production help from Tamar Fagan, our apprentice news clerk, who we welcome to the AirTalk team this her very first week, Emma Fox, and our technical director, Evelyn Bocanegra. Thank you all. Wonderful, wonderful work. Each and every day you hear the care that they put into producing these segments, bringing you the best possible guests, and particularly during election season, figuring out the Rubik's Cube represented by getting all these ballot measures, propositions, and candidates' races on the air and for the proper amount of time. Thank you so much again. Remind you, the Voter Game Plan, nothing else like it, is available at LAist.com/vote. Already more than 100,000 people have visited in just its few days. It's there for you to help you with everything that you're going to be facing on your LA and Orange County ballot. Have a terrific day.
LAist consistently delivers important news to Los Angeles and Orange County.
Hi, I'm Jill Replogle, the Orange County correspondent at LAist. The fire that broke out in Tustin last November at a World War II-era military hangar spewed asbestos into the surrounding community. For months, neighbors had crews in hazmat suits combing their front and backyards to safely remove debris. When I couldn't get a straight answer on just how far and where the toxic material had spread, I requested public documents, and we produced the only publicly available map that tracked reports of how far the debris had spread, about 10 miles from where the massive hangar burned for weeks.
LAist, connecting you to your community.